Chapter 5, Genevieve Berend. The following are quotes from her book, Your Invisible Power, published in 1921. There is nothing unusual or mysterious in the idea of your pictured desire coming into material evidence. It is the working of a universal natural law. Everything in the whole world, from the hat on your head to the boots on your feet, has its beginnings in mind and comes into existence in exactly the same manner. All are projected thoughts, solidified. Once a thing seems normal to you, it is as surely yours, through the law of growth and attraction, as it is yours to know addition after you have learned the use of figures. On previous occasions, when making my mental picture, I had felt that I was waking up something within myself. This time there was no sensation of effort. I simply counted over the $20,000. Then, in a most unexpected manner, from a source of which I had no consciousness at the time, there seemed to open a possible avenue through which the money might reach me. In a nutshell, what we visualize tends to come into being. Use this invisible but logical power to turn any desire into reality. The older prosperity manuals are often the best, and Genevieve Berend's writings provide a charming entry point to the genre. It is fascinating to sit down with Your Invisible Power after reading contemporary manifestation and law of attraction books like The Secret and Ask and It Is Given, as you realize that many of their ideas are not new, with Berend having studied and written about this material 80 years previously. Berend was the only known pupil of Thomas Troward, 1847 to 1916, a former judge in the Punjab of British India, who in his spare time had studied the world's sacred books and become a metaphysical philosopher. He was a master, according to Berend, of the laws governing the relation between the individual and the universal mind. In addition to his celebrated Edinburgh lectures, highly praised by philosopher William James, Troward is best known for his book, The Creative Process and the Individual, which argues that the fulfillment of our individual personalities is vital for the evolution of the universe. His thinking was seminal in the emergence of the New Thought movement and Ernest Holmes' Science of Mind. Troward's work is not easy reading, however, and Berend took it upon herself to simplify his ideas for a larger audience. In the manner of Florence Scovel Shinn, who also lived in New York in the 1920s, Berend's short book combines spiritual principles with anecdotes of her work to help people appreciate their abundant nature. Compared to its modern counterparts, Your Invisible Power is more focused on visualization to achieve desires, and is also distinguished by its concept that every person is God in miniature. In practical terms, this means that when you have feelings of lack, you have just forgotten your connection to divine abundance. Create order through visualization. Berend's first point is that visualization actually brings order to your mind. The universe and the mind behind it is perfectly ordered, and your use of vivid imagination allows this order to be expressed. We only have airplanes and telephones, she notes, because someone first imagined that such things could exist. All great advances are a triumph of principle over current circumstances or reality. Reality is a blurry concept when you consider that all things are first created in the mind. At the moment of their imagining, they are already part real. When the Wright brothers were designing and experimenting with their flying machines, these early craft were just the current expression of a perfect image of flight already created. After each failure, it is said that one brother would say to the other, "That's all right, brother. I can see myself riding in that machine, and it travels easily and steadily." With such strong images always in front of them, their success in creating the first workable airplane took on an air of inevitability. As Berend puts it, in visualizing or making a mental picture, you are not endeavoring to change the laws of nature. You are fulfilling them. A strong mental image summons the mysterious but unfailing law of attraction, which allows things to manifest according to what you have imagined. exploit the power of strong images. Barron notes, everyone visualizes, whether he knows it or not. We all create our futures first in the mind before they are played out in physical reality. This creates the wonderful opportunity of being able to choose those images. There is nothing weird or strange about the process. The laws of visualization, attraction, and manifestation are the natural way everything is created. As examples, she mentions railway magnate James J. Hill, whose railroad stretching from one coast of America to the other was built in his mind years before the first track was actually laid. And the millionaire Australian grazier James Tyson, who made the deserts blossom as the rose. Even when he was working for a few shillings a day as a bushman, she notes, he simply kept his thoughts centered upon the idea of making fences and seeing flowers and grass where none existed at the time. Yet what Hill and Tyson did, we all do to achieve a goal. The image of what you want is strong enough to pull you into action. Barron refers to a rather beautiful statement from St. Paul in the Bible to sum up what she is saying. The worlds are formed by the word of God. Things which are seen are not made of things which do appear. Expressions of Divine Abundance. The great architect of the universe contemplated himself as manifesting through his polar opposite, matter. Barron goes to some lengths to explain the theology behind what she describes as the law of attraction. As the previous quote indicates, there is a creative power, universal mind, or God, that generates the universe, and that, for completion's sake, likes to see thought manifested into physical form. Human beings are like the creative power in miniature, also able to turn thoughts into reality, literally to make our own worlds in the same way that God has total command over the universe. Human beings exist so that the universal mind can be differentiated, expressed in an endless variety of personalities. Therefore, by visualizing and then bringing something into form, you are fulfilling God's will for you to be unique and powerful. You fulfill your personality by creating something out of nothing. Barron notes that some people feel that it is too material and not spiritual enough to visualize things that you want to happen. Yet the deliberate manifesting of what you want is exactly what God intended for you to do. God creates with total ease and joy. So should you. Manifest money. People visited Barron at her New York rooms. Some wanted to manifest money. Others sought to be healed in some way. Many were desperate. Some were about to lose their business. Others' wives had left them. Barron would calmly assert to each that they had not been separated from their good, that this was only an illusion. To bring back their happiness or well-being, what they first had to do was reconnect to the universal substance, or God. Barron recalls a man who was about to lose the beloved home where he had grown up in the American South. Creditors were about to foreclose, and he did not know what to do. She quietly affirmed to him that the same universal power that brought him into the world did so for the purpose of expressing its limitless supply through him. Nothing could cut him off from this source, and the feeling of lack he was experiencing had no truth. She told him, "Infinite substance is manifesting in you right now." The following week, just before she was about to deliver a lecture, Barron received a message from the man. Money had come through in a miraculous way, and he had been able to telegraph an amount sufficient to pay off the mortgage. "Please tell the people this afternoon," he wrote, "about this wonderful power." You may feel ashamed to ask for what you want, but in these moments, remember Barron's idea that you are simply a smaller version of the universal mind or God. It is your nature to constantly desire and bring into being new things. Therefore, she writes, do not fear to be your true self, for everything you want, wants you. Al Barron manifested $20,000. People often ask Barron what led her to study mental science and the laws of prosperity. She always welcomed these inquiries, since she believed that a person who claimed to know psychological truths should have first tested them on themselves. After her husband died, she was bereft, but had been left enough money to live on. She wanted the world, but without inner contentment or direction. She studied Christian Science for a while, and even met Mary Baker Eddy, the movement's founder, but did not stick with it. A friend invited her to meet Abdu'l-Bahá, the seer and son of the founder of the Baha'i faith, who told her that she would travel the world over seeking the truth, and when she had found it, would speak it out. Her epiphany came when she discovered a book containing Troward's lectures. In her state of mind, she immediately fell on a certain passage, which promised that, because each person's mind is a center of the divine mind, we can experience contentment and perpetual growth in the manner of God. At that point, Baron resolved to study with Troward, but realized she would need more money than she possessed to do so. She was then in New York, and Troward was in Cornwall, England. Baron began a visualization routine every night and morning of counting out 20 $1,000 bills and seeing herself buying her ticket to London, traveling on the ship, and being accepted as Troward's pupil. She constantly affirmed to herself, "My mind is a center of divine operations," yet did not think about how she would actually get the money. She had no idea. It seemed such a large amount. Instead, she would let the power of attraction find its own ways and means. Thanks to this work in faith and visualization, the money did materialize, coming from a source she never would have thought of. In only about 6 weeks, it had gone from being an image in her mind to the reality of her bank account. Believe you already have it. You will have to get the book to find out how Baron did actually come to be Troward's pupil. It is a long story that involves solving a cryptic line from the Bible and a Parisian astrologer. Reflecting on the achievement of her aim, Baron recalls the biblical promise, "All things whatsoever thou wilt, believe thou hast received, and thou shalt receive." That is, when the idea of receiving something becomes quite normal to you, it will happen as surely as night follows day. Anticipating readers' doubts, she asks, "How can you proclaim faith in something when you do not have that faith?" In such times, she says, you have to recall and observe what faith does. Recall your state of mind when you simply had to bring something into being, and you did, and create that state of mind again. She observes, your inhibition of all doubt and anxiety enables the reassuring ideas to establish themselves and attract to themselves I can and I will ideas, which gradually grow into the physical form of the desire in your mind. By deliberately choosing positive thoughts, you set in train the action of more can-do thoughts, which can only result in positive, powerful action. The clarity of what you are visualizing, combined with your relaxed faith, makes you more open to receive the ideas and opportunities you need to achieve your goal. At the end of the book, Baron provides suggestions on how to pray or ask. All these suggestions follow the idea of ask, believing you have already received, and you shall receive. Final comments. The critical view of books like Your Invisible Power, even more so their modern equivalents, is that they pander to our materialistic side. Is it really a good use of your visualizing powers, for instance, to manifest a new BMW? This, however, would be missing the point. What you ask for is not really important in the larger scheme of things. Much more significant is the discovery that you are a co-creator in the universe, able to bring almost anything into being if you develop a relaxed belief in its coming. With this knowledge, you can never be a victim of circumstances, but rather a center of power. Some readers will feel that Your Invisible Power has too much spiritual mumbo-jumbo in it, but this simply reflects Baron's efforts to convey Troward's complex theology. A Christian who had a major influence on the development of mental science, his thinking was in fact based squarely on reason, and he resolutely opposed any kind of occult learning. The goal of Baron's writing was to help people develop a magnetic mind that can draw desired things or circumstances to them. Whether you choose to believe that these processes are purely physiological or involve spiritual forces is up to you. What matters more is whether they work, and you won't know if they do until you try them out. Genevieve Behrend. Born in 1881, information is scant on Behrend's early life except that she was a native of Paris and one of her parents was Scottish. Between 1912 and 1914, she immersed herself in Troward's teachings, and on her return to New York City, she established the School of the Builders, lectured, and gave advice to people in need. She later established another school in Los Angeles, lectured widely on mental science, and became well known through radio broadcasts. She died in 1960. Behrend's other book is Attaining Your Heart's Desire, 1929.